So when Dean talked to me back in June about possibility of doing a building while he was on vacation, one of the things that he said was, I can choose any scriptures I want. And I have always been in the discipline of preaching the lectionary. And for my entire 17 years, I preached the scriptures for that week. I thought, well, this is kind of fun. This might be part of the retirement deal, is that I get to pick and choose. And so I looked at some of the scriptures for this month, and I picked these scriptures, which are actually from the lectionary for last week. So they may have sounded familiar to you, because I think Dean did actually preach in the same scriptures last week. But I picked this particular group, the Old Testament and the New Testament and the Epistle, because there was so much low-hanging ripe fruit. It's just like a tree that's just burdened with, there's so much there to get into. And I named my message a tentative message, because even as recent as this morning, I still wasn't quite sure which one of those fruits I was going to pick today. And actually, I'm going to pick a couple and touch on them, because it's just too important. There's too much good stuff here to just talk about one thing. So the first thing I want to talk about is there is a marvelous definition of the word faith that shows up in these scriptures. And we all consider ourselves people of faith, but having a really solid definition of what that means to be a person of faith. What is it, this faith that we talk about having? So from Hebrews it says, faith is the assurance of things hoped for. The assurance, to be sure, of things that we hope for. This leads us to believe that we have the opportunity to form our future, that we can change the future by our prayers and our thoughts and our dreams. People of faith are sure that those things that they dream for are assured by God. That's a pretty sweet deal. The conviction of things not seen. We are people of the body. We are physical. We live in a physical world. But faith is the assurance that there are things greater than these things, more solid than these things, more important than these things that are unseen. It says, by faith, the worlds were prepared by the word of God, so that what is seen was made from things that are not visible. So everything that we see, everything that is physical in our world, came out of some kind of nothingness. And our creation story tells us in the beginning, there was a void. That's it. A void and the Spirit of God hovering over the void. And out of the void came everything. Stars and moons and planets, everything that we have around us, it all came out of nothingness. That's part of what it means to have faith. Luke tells us to sell your possessions and give alms, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. There your heart will be also. This is where we get into the heart language, which I love. The things that we possess, the things that we own, the things that we buy and sell, the jobs that we do, all of this stuff is important for our lives here. But ultimately, the things that God is interested in is the contents of our heart. And our heart is filled with what? I don't care what kind of car you drive. Doesn't matter. God wants to know what the content of your heart is. So from this, you can say that faith is the ultimate creative power in the universe. Right? The entire universe was created out of faith, out of trust. And I would substitute the words God and love for faith. These are the things that create in our world. I had a really good friend and a mentor for many, many years in my life, and he's gone now. But I remember many times when I was with him, and he would be with a friend, and the friend would be in some kind of problem, and he would be telling us about this difficulty that he was having. And my mentor would always respond with four words. I'd say, wait, I know it's coming, I know it's coming. And those four words would eventually come out of his mouth. And he would look at the guy and he would say, how can I help? Four words. How can I help? What can I do to alleviate your suffering? That's the kind of a heart that God is looking for. Hearts that are filled with compassion for each other. So our job then is to look at what has God given me and figure out ways to give away. That's what the faith journey is about. What are my gifts? What are the charisms that God placed in me in trust when I was born that I would go out and share them with the world? How can I do that as effectively and as efficiently as possible? The second thing that's in the scriptures today that I think is really important is a description of God. God is a hard thing to define. As soon as we start to use language, we limit. And God is limitless. So there is no language big enough to describe God. So we can only see God in little glimpses and angles and small pieces that we can hopefully stitch together into a bigger idea. Genesis says, I am your shield. Your reward will be great. I am your shield. I am in front of you wherever you go. Whatever you face in your life, it's going to have to come through me before it gets to you. Pretty nice thing to have, a shield, and particularly one that is God. And God doesn't tell us in that statement that nothing is going to get through, that we're never going to have pain, that we're never going to have problems, we're never going to have issues. But he tells us that everything that comes to us is filtered through him. And he is there to make sure that whatever gets through us, we can handle it. Hebrews says, God has prepared a city for them, for us. And Luke says, it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Doesn't say it's your Father's responsibility. Doesn't say it's your Father's desire. Father has to. It says it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. God loves giving us everything. God wants us to have everything. As a father, I understand what it's like. I want my children to have a nice place to live. I want my children to have a safe home. I want my children to have a nice place to raise my grandchildren. And that is how God sees us. And God will have them sit down to eat, and he will come and serve them. God, one that's beyond any definition, one we don't have words to describe because of his enormity, that God wants to put on an apron and come and serve us. Talk about flipping a world upside down. Think about our national leadership and how much time is spent in self-service and how much is spent in serving those of us who are on the lower rungs trying to figure out how to make it through the day. God completely fits the world's economy on its head. And he comes to serve us. And that, of course, is our example for how we are to live our lives. So we've got a couple of references to the new city. God is building us this city. And God is waiting to give it to us, to give us the keys to this city. And we want it, right? He wants to go to that city, the Holy Kingdom. So when do we go? A lot of people are content to wait until after his life is over and assume that that's when we receive the kingdom, is someday when we take our last breath, we wake up in the kingdom. But this is the kingdom of eternity. And eternity is all time. It's the past. It's future. It's present. So we live in eternity right now. The eternal kingdom is accessible right here to us today, right now. We only have to choose to live into it rather than turning our backs on it and fulfilling our own desires and our own goals and running around and doing the things that we would do for ourselves. So the eternal kingdom starts today if we choose to. Which brings me to my third and final point. When I look at scriptures and try to figure out what God is trying to say in these scriptures, I step back and I look at my community and I look at the newspaper and the news, and people I talk to, and I say, what is the message, what is the word that God needs for us to hear today? And how do these scriptures speak to that need that we have to help us get through the day, to help us get through the week, to help us move in the direction of the kingdom, which is what we're trying to do. Step by step, move towards the kingdom. Hebrews says, by faith, Abraham set out, not knowing where he was going. I don't know where I'm going. I don't know if this is the first sermon of what will be another batch of sermons, or if this is the last sermon I ever preach. I don't know. I'm pretty happy being a car builder guy. At the moment, that feels pretty good. And not that preaching doesn't feel pretty good, too. But I don't know. I have to walk by faith. I have to wait and see what God has tomorrow. I have to wait and see when the phone rings, what my next opportunity will be. By faith, Abraham stayed for a time living in tents with Isaac and Jacob. Living in tents. Anybody ever live in a tent? I know a few people have stayed in tents a few times. Yeah. What's the difference between a tent and a house?
Plumbing.
Solidity? Plumbing. Size,
electricity.
Comfort,
electricity,
permanence. That's a critical piece. Permanence. So tents come in all sizes, configurations. About a year ago, right now, I was a chaplain at the Ryder Cup golf tournament up at Hazleton, and on the grounds of the Hazleton National Golf Course, they had over 1 million square feet of tents. People were up there, know what I'm talking about. 1 million, that's 23 acres covered by tents. There was one single tent there that was over 60,000 square feet, and it was two stories. So they built a tent, and then they built a second floor, and it was essentially a department store. It was where they sold all the stuff, and there were hundreds of thousands of people in that tent, and it did have plumbing. It did have plumbing, but it was still a tent. And electricity, yes. But it was still a tent, and if the wind would have come up, at a certain point it would have gone down. The clubhouse would have stayed. The tent would have been gone. The difference between tents and houses with foundations. We here, I would make the point, are all tent dwellers. We're all like Abraham and Isaac. We're all on a journey to the promised land, to a place of permanence, a place with a foundation, a place that won't blow away. And that place is built not out of bricks and mortar or boards and steel columns. It's built out of faith. And we're all heading towards that. But for today, we're all pretty much tent dwellers. And camping is a fun thing. It's a great American pastime. We all like to go out camping. I'm not sure if you remember or not. But, at some point. My wife and I, when we were dating and moving towards permanent relationship, the first time that we ever went and bought something where she put in her money and I put in my money and we owned it together, it was a pup tent. A little two-person pup tent, a little aluminum framework you could put up in about 2 minutes, and it would provide shelter to two people. And we wore that pup tent out. We camped, we went up north on weekends, and we went on our honeymoon to Yellowstone National Park. We camped all the way out there. We camped in the park. We camped all the way back. We loved that tent. And then eventually, we had kids. And then we got a conversion van. Because we had a roof on it. And that was important. And then eventually, we got a house. And now we live in a house that has a foundation underneath it. And it's permanent. And it's going to be there after we're gone. Tents are great for a while, but they have their limitations. I know there's at least one person in this room that remembers a Boy Scout jubilee. And I think it was 90. This is the bad part about preaching in your hometown. There's always somebody out there that knows the truth. My congregation had three set people who were my teachers in high school in the pews. So if I told any stories before 1970, I had to be really careful because somebody would call me. I think it was 1965, and the state Boy Scout Camporee was in Carver, Minnesota. Well, that's right next to Chaska. And we're in Troop 323, and we're saying, hey, you know, it's really close. We're going to be the first ones there. So we got all our stuff, and we met over there on the campground. There's this huge acreage that they have set aside for Boy Scouts coming all across the state. And we said, let's take that high spot right on top of the hill, and we'll overlook the whole scene for the whole campery all weekend long. So we picked that spot, and we set up our tents. And as we're setting up our tents, it's starting to get dark. And it's starting to feel that when things start to look green, and it's just, you can feel there's something going on in the air. And then all at once, we see, here's the wall cloud. It's just black. And it's coming towards us. And so we all scramble for our tents. And those tents didn't have floors. It was a two-person tent. And it was just a tarp underneath. And all of a sudden, we can see this wall coming. And as it comes, we can see tents that are flying in the air. And as they're flying, you know, knives and backpacks and clothes are falling through the air from these tents that are flying overhead. And somebody yells, the scoutmaster's tent. We have one tent that has a pole in the center, a wall tent. And so everybody scrambles out of their tent and runs to the scoutmaster's tent. And there were about 15 of us. We were packed in like sardines. We're just crammed in there, trying to hold this one piece of ground against what turned out to be 106 mile an hour winds that were recorded that day. And I was one of the last guys in. So I was up against the wall of the tent. And there were hailstones the size of golf balls. And I can remember bouncing off my head, off my back, as we struggled to hold that tent down for 3 minutes or however long it lasted. And when it was done, we crawled out and we looked around and it was just out. There was nothing left standing. Everything was, the leaves were off the trees. Everything was just a mess. And one of the scoutmasters, I don't know if it was Hollis or 80, one of them went somewhere and made a phone call and got a flatbed truck, and they came out with a flatbed truck. And we just took our whole campsite and we just rolled it up, tents and sleeping bags and clothes and stuff, whatever, rolled it all up, and we threw it on this flatbed truck and brought it back to the city hall, which is where the Wells Fargo Bank is now, that's our headquarters, and sorted it all. That was not a good day to be in a tent. Not a good day. And fortunately, we were smart enough to get out while we could. So, if we are tent dwellers here, we are pilgrims on our way somewhere. And as human beings and as adults, we all love freedom, right? This is America. We're all about freedom. Freedom of press, freedom of religion, freedom to vote, freedom to pick where we live, who we live with, freedom of everything, and we all cherish our freedom, and we protect it, and we support it, and we do everything else we can do to increase our freedom in the world. But as adults, we're still children in God's eyes. And I think that even as we yearn and seek out freedom, at our core, in our heart, what we really look for is stability, safety, something we can count on, something with a foundation, where we can go in the basement if we have to, if it's that bad. And God is trying to take us to that place. As God's children, we're seeking the thing that we don't even know that we're seeking, stability. And I think back to when my daughter Kate was young. She was a good baby most of the time. But like all babies, she had her moments where she could not be consoled. And I don't remember who it was that taught us the idea of swaddling. Everybody familiar with swaddling? You've seen what it does to babies, how it works. Just wrap them as tight as you possibly can so they can't move a muscle, and all of a sudden they're calm. And all of a sudden they relax because they know they're safe. They know they have stability in their parents' arms. They understand. And like children, we're all yearning for that kind of stability. We want to know our kids are safe, our grandkids are safe, we're safe, we're stable. Hebrews talked about the 2,000 years of Christians before us. These all died in faith, not having received what was promised. Every Christian since day one has looked forward to the second coming, to the kingdom of God, to the parousia, to that moment when we all are separated or whatever your beliefs are about what that looks like. And nobody has ever seen it. So far, nobody has ever seen it. And odds are, there's a pretty good chance I'm not going to see it either. Just saying, there's a chance. And I hate to tell you, but it may not happen on your watch either. But if we have faith that the kingdom exists, if we have faith that by doing the right thing and being the kind of people that God wants us to be and taking care of each other, we'll find our way to the kingdom. I don't need the kingdom today, because I've been to the mountaintop, as Martin Luther King would say. I've heard the promise, and I know it to be true. And for me, for today, that's enough. Let's pray. Lord God, we humbly thank you for the gifts of this day, for our daily bread, for the friendships that we share, for the opportunity to be of service, and for peaceful rest at the day's end. Help us to move gently in the direction of your will for our lives, like a canoe headed downstream. Help us to seek out the places where we can be of service to our brothers and sisters and steer away from the turbulence of self-will and false pride, that we might all come to rest on the shore of your kingdom, together, forever. Amen.